The last time we met in this chamber, the mothers and daughters of Afghanistan were captives in their own homes, forbidden from working or going to school. Today, women are free.
If you go and talk to women in Afghanistan and you say, do you feel liberated? I would guarantee you that over 80% would say, you know, no, I don't feel liberated.
They went to Afghanistan and they put the same people who the people of Afghanistan called them terrorists. They put those people back in power. It's like replacing one set of terrorists with another set of terrorists in Afghanistan. And then we call that the liberation of women of Afghanistan.
There is very little change between now and when the Taliban were in power.
4 years after the U.S. invasion,
the fundamentalists still control Afghan society.
90% of the women of Afghanistan still cannot read and write. There is no classes for them. There is no school for them. 95% of women do not have any money, do not have any job, do not have any education. And then we talk about the liberation of women of Afghanistan. The rape and abduction, the forced marriages are still there. Women are in jail just because they run away from their abusive husbands.
Women are just pouring cooking oil on themselves. They burn themselves because they are so desperate that they don't see any more hope. They don't see any future for themselves.
A woman was dying right in front of my eyes. And that was the third woman in 2 weeks who was dying from burns.
The fact that the Taliban are gone is good for women. I can't overstate that. But it's not exactly liberation immediately. And certainly opened the door to a potential liberation of Afghan women.
Today is the big day. We're all getting on a flight to go to Kandahar to have our women's conference on the Constitution. There's going to be about 40 of us. Some of us are coming in from India, some of us are coming in from the United States, and of course all these different provinces have gathered. What's important to us is that the women get to know women from other parts of the country, that we all in sisterhood talk about the future of women in this country and the Constitution.
The most exciting thing is that these women want this exchange to happen, which is what we wanted. This is the whole reason we're doing this. And to hear it come out of their mouths without us having to prompt it is just, it's just music to the ears.
We chose Kandahar because it was the former stronghold of the Taliban. It's still one of the most conservative cities in Afghanistan. And it also happens to be the city of my birth.
These women have done things that some of us would never dream of and put themselves and their children and their husbands at risk. They don't have security. They don't have a passport like the rest of us do to just leave the country.
My husband is very good man. He is very free man. But the Kandahar people, they don't like for the women work, don't like without burqa.
Is it very hot?
Yes. That is very hot.
And uncomfortable.
Especially in the summer. But for the winter, it's good. It's warm, yes.
We're concerned about security. We're going to be taking every precaution we can. And we're going to stay in our compound and not try to have a lot of movement in and out of the compound. And we will have security guards all through the trip. It is a huge challenge to the fundamentals. That's why we're doing it. We're actually doing it for the women, but that happens to be a challenge to the fundamentalists.
موضوع مسئله قانون اساسی است که ما شما در آستانه قانونسازی قرار داریم و می‌لرزیم. بگویید خود قانون چیست؟ قانون چیست؟ کی میگه قانون چیست؟ چی معنا داره؟ شما؟
عبارت از قواعد و مقررات و اصول مجموعه قواعد مقررات و اصول.
این چی معنا داره؟ و چی وقت با وجود آمده؟ کی برای ما میگه که قانون اساسی چی وقت با وجود آمده؟
The 1964 Afghan constitution gave men and women equality. Most people find it hard to believe that Afghan women essentially had equality under the constitution of 1964.
That time, during King, they declared a woman's right, and women could go without burqa. My mother, my mother-in-law, my sister, during 60s, they were open, just like I am here now.
At that time, there was more peace in Afghanistan. Afghanistan was a religious country, but it was not fanatic. The government of Afghanistan was a secular government. The fundamentalists did not have much power in Afghanistan. We had people who were extreme religious, extreme leftist, or anti-religion, or atheist, or communist, but they all lived together. There was more tolerance then in Afghanistan 40 years ago than today. But there was social injustice there too. The king's family were ruling the country for 200 years. Most of the government and higher position jobs were in their hands.
He was cool king, and he didn't torture people. He didn't do much for Afghanistan either. Because only in Kabul city we had hospital or telephone or a paved streets. In the proverb and suburb and other cities, we were poor. We had only 3% literate in Afghanistan.
It was a time when people wanted to do something about the poverty in Afghanistan. Political parties, one after another, popped up. And one of these parties were the People's Democratic Party, which was a Marxist party.
The people who founded the party, all these young people, intellectual people, they wanted the progress of Afghanistan.
The party was for the poor people and equality for people and workers' rights, labor's rights, union, women's rights, human rights. All these words sounded very good, and of course all these things were missing in Afghanistan. They thought that the money and the wealth is concentrated in just a small class of the society. And by bringing socialism, they will change the system. They thought that socialism is the only way for poor people to be equal. It was the biggest party in Afghanistan.
ما در اون سالا سازمان دموکراتیک زنای افغانستان ایجاد کردیم با 6 نفر در سال 1964 و این سازمان ما نه تنها در تمام حرکات روشنفکرانه که از پوهنتون کابل آغاز میشد و مکاتب در بر میگرفت اشتراک فعال داده بودن زنا را در کنار مردها مشترکن در اعتصابات، تظاهرات، میتینگ ها و عمل.
constitution gave us the right. But because the society did not give us the right, it made it difficult.
I saw that injustice in my family too, that men were treated better than women, and that bothered me, and I always wanted to do something about it.
They asked me to join the party, and I went and helped. We were going and talking to women and raise awarenesses. We were forming literacy classes to teach women how to read and write. It was dangerous, but you learn how to hide. We had study groups. We talk about what Lenin or Marx and Engels wrote, and we analyzed them and we talked about it. And of course, if you read Marxism, the philosophy is so deep. It's just you learn so much from it. And a lot of things that Marx wrote, you can see today in the United States, today in the world, in the imperialistic world. It gave us a lot of knowledge and a lot of courage. I grew up with all these dedicated men and women who really worked for women's rights and human rights. We all were working together. That was our life. And it was friendship. It was very deep and clean and decent friendship.
I was at 12th grade, and we had to demonstrate somehow. A mullah or mujahideen, they throw acid to the lady's leg and the faces without a veil.
This is an Islamic party.
One of those groups was the group of Gulbuddin Hekmatyar.
During kingdom.
But they were not that strong. People did not like them. But they were condemned because that was act of crime against women. Then over the next 30 years, because the U.S. supported them with money, these fundamentalist groups formed international terrorist groups, spread fanaticism all over the world, and they came to control and dominate Afghanistan.
We brought women from all over Afghanistan to work on the Constitution and Bill of Rights and show the world that the women in Afghanistan do believe in their rights and they do fight for their rights. Maghfirat Samimi works with human rights and she goes to very dangerous areas, areas that the women should not be going.
از آن کمک‌های نقدی که به درد مردم ما نمی‌خورد، به دست مردم ما نمی‌رسد. مصرف تعمیرات بلند منزل و موتورهای لوکس می‌گردد. بهتر است که زمینه کار و وسایل کار برای ما مهیا گردد. ملل متحد و دولت انتقالی اسلامی افغانستان در رفع بیکاری اقدامات اساسی نمایند. بعد از بیکار شدن حکومت موقت انتقالی اسلامی افغانستان، کمتر تغییرات در زندگی اجتماعی مردم مشاهده می‌کنیم.
I go to Afghanistan 2-3 times a year.
I'm working on opening literacy classes. Here, 40% were girls. So we gave them school supplies, everything that they needed, from papers and pens to blackboards and even carpets. Over 5,000 students got school supplies there. If you want to bring security to a country, if you want to bring peace to a country, if you want to fight terrorism, education is a must. That's why I started those schools there for the kids.
When I was in first grade of college, there was a coup in Afghanistan by Daoud. And he declared for the first time in Afghanistan presidency.
Every day, women's situation was getting better and better. Women were gaining more support and more freedom. We had women cabinet members.
Dawood had plans for developing Afghanistan and asked the US for aid, but they did not do much. So he threw himself into the arm of the Soviet Union.
There were opposition from the fundamentalists. And that is why Dawood outlawed religious political parties.
Fundamentalist leaders like Hikmatyar went to Pakistan.
Then as Dawood did not reform as the People's Democratic Party wanted, there were some disagreement and there were some dissatisfaction with Dawood, and that is why he put them, some of them, in prison.
Then something happened with one of the very famous and popular guy, Mirakbare Khaybar, who was very good and very popular as a teacher, as a leader in the Party Democratic of Afghanistan. He was killed. Of course, everybody blamed the government. People were very angry.
And that was the reason that the April Revolution started.
There were tensions amongst women. It wasn't that women just sort of got into a room and bonded. There were ethnic issues. There were other fears and experiences.
There's a lot of accomplished women there coming from all over the country, some in very prominent high positions. They stand up and shout, women's rights, we want women to do this, we want women to do that. But the average woman here, who's a housewife, an illiterate, working class, they won't even listen to these poor women. To help empower women. Athens for Civil Society started a women's law group with six women, and the six women represent women both educated and non-educated. To our surprise, it's the non-educated, the illiterate women who contributed most to the conversations. Mangal being one example.
The People's Democratic Party took power by a military coup organized by Hafiz Lamin.
Nur Muhammad Taraki became president and Babrak Karmal became a vice president.
When the communists came to power, people were very happy. There were celebrations all over Afghanistan.
Many people joined the party.
They had members in the army, in the police force, and farmers, and labor union. Of course, women was a big force of the party.
Feudals got afraid because the government is taking their land and giving to the farmers. Those feudals went to Pakistan and took a gun against the government. And then people start fleeing.
But not everybody left because of the communists. Some of the people left because feudals and the fundamentalists were threatening them. And they left.
The party member, they said, if I leave, if you leave, if he leave, if she leave, who will build that country? Who will fix this country? Somebody should sacrifice and stay and do it. And those people stayed behind.
Unfortunately, there were some corrupt leadership in the party. One was Hafiz Lami. He recruited for himself people who were crooks and corrupt.
After 4 or 5 months, Amin killed President Taraki. He became president, a vice president, minister of defense, minister of foreign affairs, and minister of interior affairs.
He put very decent member of the party in jail, and he killed a lot of them, even guilt by association, somebody who said something negative.
زندانی هم شدن که خودم از جمله از زندانی هست که شکنجه های چه اگه من بگرم شکنجه های بسیار غیر انسانی که تا حال در وجود خودم هم آثار فراوانش دیدم.
I was prison in jail for 1 year. He doesn't like to join the communist party. I am Muslim. I know communists not believe Allah. And when I come free, come head of the Mujahideen, means freedom fighter.
I was threatened. That's why I left Afghanistan. I was fortunate not to be killed there.
25,000 people was in jail during Taraki. After that, they killed all of them. Afiz Lamin killed.
Those who really believed in socialism, those who really believed in social justice, they were not the corrupt people, but those who took power and they pretended that they believe, they were the one, the corrupt people, and they just gave, you know, the party a bad name.
7 people from the party resigned. Then they decided to ask Russian to help them change the government. Russian helped them to get back to Afghanistan with the troops to finish with Hafiz Lamin. Hafiz Lamin was killed. And Vice President Babrak Karmal became president.
Babrak Karmal opened the jails. He tried to reunite the party and convince Afghans that Amin's nightmare was over. He would be in power for the next 6 years.
The US was not prepared to send its troops to fight what it perceived to be Soviet aggression. So the US asked Pakistan to become its frontline ally against the Soviet Union in that region. U.S. aid through the CIA to the Pakistani army and the Pakistani ISI, their intelligence services, started to occur. That military aid was then channeled to what came to be known as the Mujahideen forces in Afghanistan.
They gave them more weapons, they gave them more supplies, money, and Tora Bora.
They were being trained both in the use of military equipment and they were being trained in ideology, you know, gonna go fight the jihad, you know, give up your life for the jihad.
They created these religious fanatics.
because they thought that the only thing that they can use against the Russian and defeat the Russian in countries like Afghanistan would be religion.
The official version, right, is that we started supplying aid to the, quote, rebels after the Soviets invaded in December of 79. In fact, Carter's regime started supplying the so-called rebels much prior. By July 79, the covert aid had already started.
President Reagan did the most damage there, actually.
I'm going to repeat how honored I am by these visitors that we have with us, six from the Afghanistan freedom fighters.
These same fundamentalist factions whose followers were responsible for throwing acid on women's faces, right? Way back when, at the beginning of the 70s, we were helping them because we felt it was in our geopolitical interests to get the Soviets in there, to then, you know, bog them down in what did end up to be a 10-year war for them.
Afghanistan became part of the great game between the US and the USSR
in order to control the resources and, of course, oil and natural gas located right there in that region. Brzezinski's book talks about it.
The Soviet Union must pay a concrete price for their aggression.
From 79 to 89, Afghanistan was at war. The war was not of Afghan against Russian. The war was the war of American and Russian, but with the blood of Afghan people. It was a war fought mostly in the rural areas. On one side was the army of the Afghan government in the Soviet Union. And on the other side was the Mujahideen or Jihadis backed by the US government.
Every day the Mujahideen was getting stronger, getting more weapon.
توند شهیدان به کیدله په دمش کوڅه د شاو په د خاط ریاست جدید شهر نو کې نیان غچان پران کړ د شهیدان کې چې په سایګان شهید په خبرو اترس نه په دمش په دوستان شهیدان
They would burn villages, burn crops, spill acid on women's face, rape women. One way or the other, force the villagers to get out of their village. The international community gave money to help the millions and millions of refugees who came from Afghanistan and filling up the refugee camps in Pakistan. And that money was channeled through the fundamentalist leaders, through the warlords, and they pocketed much of the money. In addition, they forced many of the refugees, especially the young men, to join their militia and fight the jihad. Where the jihadis were in power, the situation was very bad. There were no schools, no colleges. Women were forced to stay home. The areas where the government had power, economically, they were doing much better.
Even though they were in the war. They were building the mosques, building their schools, producing teachers and doctors, producing hospitals, universities. If you see the Afghanistan history, any government who made a lot was Democratic Party of Afghanistan.
ما زنای ما در بدست آوردن حقوق هم تلاش های فراوان کردن. ما گفتیم که کودکستان های محل کار برای تسهیلات زنایی که کار میکردن و معلم بودن، دکتر بودن یا کارمند دولتی بودن، بلا استثناء در دواهر هر روز امی کودکستان های محل کار ایجاد میشد. رخصتی های قبل از ولادت و بعد از ولادت تا مدت 3 ماه با حفظ کار که قبلا 40 روز بوده، این تا 3 ماه بلند بردن که در امی مدت میتونیست که پیش از ولادت و بعد از ولادت از این رخصتی های خود با حفظ کار و معاش استفاده کن.
They gained a lot of rights. Their situation improved so much. So many women were educated in the 80s.
In my class, it's the 700%, not women, women and men. But in the 700, it's maybe 250% is women. Today, they have 15%.
Women were working in the society, in every aspect of life.
پلار ویل چې د وزو مې اوس ما خو زما د پلار اصلي مسلط ولدا کورس راغلی تاسې پوهی چې که چې زموږ خوښه نه وه موږ ډېر سخت.
It's interesting, that period in the late 70s and 80s was a time of women's rights, ironically, under the communist regime. But I think that for most women, Islam is so important to them that, you know, that system, even though it gave women rights, in some cases, is just not workable.
We wanted to get out of the conference and go for a sightseeing. The shrine was the only place that the women were allowed to go. I remember 40 years ago, we went to this sightseeing and to that sightseeing. You know, things have changed very much to the worse in the past 30, 40 years in Afghanistan.
ای کشورم، ای مادرم، قربانی تو آمادم، تا پای جان در سنگرم، در حفظ تو استادم.
Are you okay?
By 1986, the people of the Soviet Union really didn't want to support the war anymore. It had become extremely unpopular. And so in that sense, it really had become the Soviet Union's Vietnam War. Gorbachev, who was in power, had decided that the way for the Soviet Union forward was, in fact, to embrace a neoliberal model of the market economy. And he was supported very much by the ruling elites. They had been seeing the war in Afghanistan as really draining the resources.
We should like, in the nearest future, to withdraw Soviet troops stationed in Afghanistan at the request of its government.
These oligarchs really wanted to get their hands on and to enrich themselves as a way to enter into this new liberal market economy and make themselves the sort of leaders of that new era that they saw coming. Babrak Kamal, who had been the leader of the PDPA and closely affiliated with the Soviet Union, he sort of was basically forced to resign. Najibullah was then named the president, he became the secretary of the PDPA.
Dr. Najib changed the Marxist Party, and he brought a lot of people who were not communists into the party. He worked for peace, and he wanted peace very much, and he did ask these jihadis to come and speak and talk about the problems. Let's just talk, let's just bring peace. And he was begging people. He had Quran in his hand, and he was reading from Quran, and he was begging them.
In 1988, Pakistan, the United States, and the USSR agreed finally to sign the Geneva Accords. That basically meant that they agreed to cease hostilities, and that's when the USSR started to withdraw its troops.
The Russian went home. I remember that date, and we were all standing and saying goodbye on the streets to Russians. But nothing changed. Nothing changed. Still, rebels were fighting, still bombing. I was teaching at the Kabul University. I was seeing everyday bomb around me. I don't know how I survived.
Pakistan, ISI, the Arab countries, other Western countries, and the US all continued to help the Mujahideen against the Afghan government. The Dr. Najib Bullah government and the Afghan National Army did fight for 3 years.
In 92, there was a negotiation between Pakistan, Afghanistan, and United Nations to stop the war. Because in Afghanistan, people wanted to stop the war, and the government wanted to stop the war.
Then a group of the army went and sided with the Mujahideen. That is when the Dr. Najib government collapsed. And eventually, the fundamentalist Mujahideen leader, Burhanuddin Rabbani, became the president. Most of the destruction you see is done by the fundamentalists from 92 to 96. There are so many different groups controlling one region, one area in each city. In the crossfighting, the buildings were destroyed and people were killed and the country was devastated.
The Mujahideen destroyed almost every building, every house here. The gentleman recognized me. I said, I'm looking for my home, where is my home? And he brought me here.
Well, there are several rocket attacks. They burned the whole house with 3 stories.
If he has not told me this is my home, I would have not recognized it. For years and years, my brother and sister, they did not hear about each other. They did not find out about each other. And I did not know where they are. Finally, my brother found out that they are alive. These people were like wild animals. Everywhere they went, they destroyed and they killed.
In 1 year, 25,000 people got killed in the city of Kabul. How much atrocity was done in Afghanistan under the name of Islam?
اطفال دخترای نابالغ یعنی بسنین بسیار خرد به زور گرفته میشد اختطاف میشدند تجاوز بالایشان صورت می زندگی بر زنا بسیار نه تنها بر زن که بر تمام مردم افغانستان زندگی در افغانستان به جهنم می رفت هر روز تبدیل می شد
They said women should stay home because they should only produce but I don't believe in that And as a human being, I have a heart, I have a brain, I have a feeling, I have everything right like a man has. And for this reason, it was hard for me and for my family, which were like doctors and mostly, and physicians. They couldn't serve in Afghanistan. We had to leave Afghanistan. And we all left.
در همین زمان بود که ما در اول سپتامبر همین 1992 بر از اینکه زنا دست به خودکشی ها به خاطر از اینکه زنا را باید به آیندهشان امیدوار بسازن خاطر که آینده را بسیار تیره و تاریک می دیدن و ما اونا را امیدوار می ساختیم که دست از خودکشی ها و سوختاندن ها و اینا دست بردارن و در پلوی از او باید تعلیم و تربیه را و صنایع دستی را ما ترویج می دادیم.
The women of Afghanistan did not lose their rights under the Taliban. They lost their rights before the Taliban, when the fundamentalist Mujahideen in 1992, when they came to power, that's when they lost their rights.
دغه د رباني ګروپ مسعود سیاف ګلبدین دغه قمندان دغه ټول دغه په خلکو په وینه باندې لاسونه یې لړلې دي دغه لمنې یې لړلې دي چې د کمونستان نه زیاتره لړلې دي
خنسه خیمه جان اوغو د قانون ووژه ګرده کاروندې راته خراب کړې دغه خانواد کې کتوي د خانواد کمونستان په بل مخ کې په هغه وخت وو
افغانستان هاف تھری ګروپ اف وومن ون ګروپ واز کمونست They tried to broke the family law, they broke the Islam law, everything. The fundamental woman, wear the black burqa, no rights for a woman. A large number of the women, they are freedom fighter. They are open-minded Muslim. We not accepted the communist idea. Just we accepted how much rights Islam gave us. The woman will be careful. If they broke the family law, they broke their custom, all the family will not accept that one. How 30 women is coming here? How they are dancing here?
The thing about the oppression of women is that women are the honor of the family, that their virginity makes a family's reputation. And if a woman does go out and is exposed to other men, then the family can't marry her off.
The problem has always been, I think, that in heavily patriarchal societies and cultures, even poor men feel they have a right to control their wives. So the women remain at the bottom of the dung heap, so to speak. I have been involved through my own work as an academic, scholar, and a performer in the alternative theater movement in Pakistan. Men and women from the most oppressed segments of Pakistani society are working together to get their problems out on the national stage. Gender oppression and class oppression are actually two faces of the same coin in a capitalist system. Men need to recognize that oppression, they need to fight against it, but they need to fight against it with and alongside their women, not by turning on those women. Society can't change without men and women working together.
Group of Mujahideen, known as Taliban, take over the South. By 1996, the Taliban had taken over most of the country and the Mujahideen were pushed to the north.
First thing they did, they killed Dr. Najibullah in the headquarters of the United Nations.
Najibullah was the last president of the communist regime. He was hung in front of the palace with money and cigarettes stuffed in his pocket. Symbols of his corruption, symbolized by the Taliban as someone who did not belong
to the Afghan way of life.
Before Taliban regime, I work in Afghan Airlines, and my father also work in there. And when the Taliban coming, they didn't like woman working. Some Taliban people coming in my house and ask about me, where's your daughter? And start to beat my father. They shot my brother. They shot my brother and his leg. And they take my father, and my father lost. I've lost. He's gone. Still, I don't know where they was.
دوره طالبان بود، نه تنها راوا که تعداد زیاد کسای دیگه هم که در اینجوا کار میکنن کورسایی داشتن، اونا مخفی بود، یعنی کس نمیدید.
بله، خطر که ما سرمت شده یکی چند بار بود که تحقیق شدادم و بالاخره منجر به ایشد که اونا باید داخل و امو اولی شوند و تختر شکستاندن و تهدید هم شدم. ولی خوشبختانه که چون دخترها از محل بودن و پدرهایشان مانع ازی شد که باید اونا بالای ما کدام کار را انجام داده نتونه.
RAWA is the Revolutionary Association of Women of Afghanistan. Under the Mujahideen, under the Taliban, they started literacy classes, they had schools, clinics, they had income-generating projects. RAWA's women are very dedicated. Some of the stuff that they did was really heroic. And they were the one actually exposed the jihadis and the Taliban to the world, their crime and their atrocity to the world.
نظر راواز در قسمت دولت که میاد که سیکولاریزم باشه، یعنی جدایی دین از سیاست باشه، به خاطر از این که تا امروز ما دیدیم که وقتی که احزاب اسلامی حاکم شدن در افغانستان، دیدیم که مردم ما روزگار سیاره دیدن.
این یک به شکل بسیار دراماتیک به وجود آمد و همه آمدن مجاهدین با آمدن طالبا به زندگی عادی زنها تبدیل شده بود، به زندگی عادی ما تبدیل.
The Taliban and the Mujahideen are the same people. When their interests crash, they are against each other. But their ideology is the same. They came from the same school of thought.
I always say that the difference between the Mujahideen and the fundamentalist Taliban is the length of their beard. All of them were raised and supported and trained in Pakistan and those madrasas and by the US, by the CIA, by the Pentagon, and by the Saudis and by the ISI of Pakistan. They are the same people.
These madrasas were essentially, they were orphanages for the children who had been orphaned in the ongoing Afghan wars. And there were people who came in from foreign countries, grown men who were being sent in to train in these madrasas.
People like Bin Laden, Gulbuddin Hikmatyar, and Sayyaf, these people later formed the terrorist groups, Al-Qaeda and others, and it's a big headache for the US.
And that bled over into extremist groups that were allied to them in Pakistan. Pakistan, like Afghanistan, prior to what happened starting in the 1970s, was a secular country. People are primarily Muslim and they believe in the religion of Islam, but it was never anything that interfered with the business of state. Really, fundamentalist Islamic groups, until very recently, have never held any kind of power in the government. Brzezinski in 1998 was asked in an interview in Le Nouvel Observateur, what did he think about you know, the fact that we aided the creation of these groups and terrorists and so on. And did he have any second thoughts? And he said, what second thoughts? He said, you know, if you look at the larger picture of history, what's more important? A few stirred up, I think he used the term, stirred up Muslims. But that's all they were to him. I mean, is that more important than the fact that we helped to create conditions that led to the demise of the Soviet Union and the end of the Cold War? And now we create big brouhaha about these terrorists. Well, excuse me, the chickens have come home to roost, haven't they?
When the US invaded Afghanistan, they parachuted inside of Afghanistan and gave briefcases full of money to the Mujahideen, to those warlords called the Northern Alliance, to go and fight for them against the Taliban. Together they defeated the Taliban, and that's how the fundamentalist warlords came back to power.
U.S. installed Mr. Karzai, who used to work for Unocal Oil Company, which is a U.S. company.
Mr. Karzai has not much power. He does not have army, he does not have police. So far in 3 years, only 15,000 in Afghan army. He's surrounded by the warlords. They can pay their militia more than the Afghan government can pay their national army.
The private militias in Afghanistan, which are estimated about 100,000 men right now, are loyal to particular warlords. They fought in Soviet times and essentially made all these war dividends. And so they have an interest in continuing their profits. As much control as they can have over people and regions and money flow and opium, the more power they have.
Jaredash is like an hour from the city of Kandahar. There are like over 60,000 refugees there. People left their homes after the invasion of the US in the end of 2001. The ethnic differences are promoted by the warlords because that is how they make their money.
He was in one of the commander's personal prison for 3 months.
همی کسایی که ظلم کردن، کسایی که جنایت کردن، کسایی که تجاوز کردن اینا شناخته شوان، اینا برای اینکه مردم هیچگاه اینا را عفو نخواد کردن تخطی های حقوق بشر که در افغانستان صورت گرفته بله، کار واقعا مشکل است ولی در افغانستان ضرور است
In Kandahar, we met with some of the women in prison and learned that some of them were in prison for traveling without a male relative.
We don't know if the ones in there are their children or are they other prisoners.
They're prisoners. We brought three of them back to our compound.
I talked with three women. One is 14, one is 15, one another is, I don't know how old they are, old, I don't know. Just detail, they are crying, I'm very, very sad, yes. Talib give one woman from Kabul and bring here. And they sell to another man, this woman. And they sell to another man. And also another man sell to another man. She tell judge, I don't live with this man. Please help with me. He bring judge, bring she and the jail. Sorry, I can't talk this name because he knew they killed me. Yeah, we have a lot of problem, you don't know. Yes, Afghan women have a lot of problem. Dangerous living, I think. Like animal.
Do you have anything for women which are abused and their right is violated against them? So, like building a shelter.
This kind of a shelter is needed, provided that it's managed properly. If we don't have sufficiently good management, clean management, it's better not to have it. I don't want women to be imprisoned in the existing prisons there. Even if they're... Because I believe, first of all, most of the crimes that the women are committing, they are not the crimes which they are initiating. I'll be ready to help, only if somebody could assure me of good management.
Well, I mean, you are the governor. Who can reassure you?
The government should not manage these things.
Okay. I mean, then you are not opposed to it and you will help. Be helpful.
Oh, definitely. I will help. But I said the only thing which I don't want is the management in the hand of the government. I'm worried about the corruption in the government circles.
Over the course of the days, I definitely saw a change in the women. They started to sort of take responsibility for what was going on with the conference.
The active participation of women was so good, they wanted changes in the constitution. Women became together and discussed and made the Afghan Women's Bill of Rights.
On behalf of all of us in Women for Afghan Women, the Afghan sisters and the non-Afghan sisters, I want to say thank you and congratulations. I'm so impressed by your hard work.
The Bill of Rights was a collective work of the women to work against the violence, to work for equal rights, for education, choosing their future husband, choosing their destiny.
Afghan Women's Bill of Rights, Kandahar 2003. On behalf of the women of Afghanistan, we make the following demands.
Mandatory education for women.
Health services for women with special attention to reproductive rights.
Economic opportunities for women.
Full inclusion of women in the judiciary system.
Her rights of inheritance.
Equal pay for equal work.
The prevention and criminalization of sexual harassment against women, publicly and in the home.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Karaglas, khoshamadin, welcome. We took in consideration our religion. We took in consideration the positive culture of Afghanistan. Not just women, but also men. They tried very hard to make sure that what is the right of Afghan women in full should be in this constitution. I am proud to say that what women have asked and what they have hoped, they are in all in the constitution of Afghanistan.
We visited with President Karzai in Kabul and we presented him with the Afghan Women's Bill of Rights.
یرا ولماي امي جماعت ولماي افغانستانم کی جلسه
اول مذهب بارے کی چ مذهب باید آزاد وي دا چې د خپل نوې ټول مذهب ته مل باید کرام لرو دا سم چې وو د بل مذهب پیسا دا بل دا چې اول تو پکسالاری ته ما باندې ونسي او سلا پر نسي قانون اساسي وڅنګ پاره کې پر دېکسي هیڅ امکان نه نسي پر دېکسي دا قانون اساسي باید عملی جنبا ولیلی او پا جی که باید عدالت و مساوات و کک بچه طول مرد سی
دو ماه پیش شان بود در این جلسه خود بسیار بازاحات گفتن این کافی رو با شما برای خواهران ما بیتل که اونا پیشان باشن که باز با او رفرنس کنن با او گفتن که زنهای افغانستان حق طبیعی تعلیم و درس خواندن و چی شمولیت در سیاست امور اجتماعی و اقتصادی افغانستان به تمام معنا دارد.
When the Constitution came out, we were devastated because none of those items were incorporated into the Constitution. When we talked to the women who were on the Constitutional Drafting Commission, really powerful women, they said, actually, it was very difficult getting rights, women's rights incorporated into this document to the degree that we wanted, and that there were a lot of conservative pressures. There is a clause about equality between men and women, although there's other language that can negate that. What's going to happen is it's going to be left up to the courts to decide, essentially probably the Supreme Court to decide. And as we know, the Supreme Court in Afghanistan right now is headed up by Chief Justice Shinwari, who's conservative.
Religious clerics became very powerful in the last 20 plus years in Afghanistan. They have the power of gun, they have the power of money, they have the position. You know, they are running the whole show there in Afghanistan.
We're only a few years removed from the rule of terrorists, when women were denied education and every basic human right. That tyranny has been replaced by young democracy, and the power of freedom is on display across Afghanistan.
That kind of hypocrisy is just mind-boggling. When we say we're going in there to defend the rights of Afghan women, we, in fact, have helped to create the conditions and aid and abet those same people who trample on human rights, who trample on women's rights, who trample on minority rights. And it's all for what? For domination of the world's resources and for domination, pure and simple.
The common people do not trust America. They've only seen America aligning with warlords, with commanders, with people who were the enemies and are the enemies of the Afghan people. Warlords have built homes that are worth millions of dollars. There's been enough proof that they are being channeled with money from sources connected with America.
The U.S. presence in Afghanistan has two benefits for the U.S. One is China, which is getting stronger and stronger, and they're afraid that China would be another superpower. And another is the oil in the region, the oil in Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan, and in that area.
They have virtually unfettered access to Persian Gulf. Now it has established military bases there. It's a power game to keep the same people in power, to keep the riches and the oil wealth and so on concentrated in the same hands. It all becomes part of this great game, which is ultimately one of keeping the status quo the same the world over. So women's oppression becomes part of this great game. Until we learn to deal with power differently and to really want to redistribute that power,
I think this game will continue and women will always be the victims, and the issues of their rights or lack thereof will always end up being used in this way.
Safia Amajan, who attended our conference in September of 2003, was assassinated by the fundamentalists. And all what she was doing simply to help women to be educated. It is not like the 60s and 70s when the movement was to change the society. Today the struggle is for survival, for basic human rights. Even that is very dangerous. But Afghan women are determined not to be victims.
ما باید قبول کرد وقتی که ما میخواییم بر زن خواهر را انجام بدیم باید خطرات پذیراش.
There are a lot of women and men who are doing this work.
حق زن و حقوق زن را میخواییم. آزاد باشیم، آزاد کار کنیم، از خود دفاع کردن کنیم.
باشه آرام باشه که سجرت پویدت نکنه.
I think these are the things that ultimately make the difference at the grassroots level, not sort of big decrees up there.
یک جنبش بین المللی ضرورت است که کمک کنه مردم افغانستان در تغییرش.
I have been doing this for over 30 years and I have not reached my goal yet, but the fight is still going on.
I think that people are really, really hopeful. And that they feel like with themselves, their minds, their bodies, their souls, they're going to rebuild Afghanistan, no matter what it takes.
Problems that present solutions. Look, there's a lot going on. Pay attention.
Revolution.